when they said unto me, let's go up to the house of the Lord together.
friend. God will fill you afresh. Father, we give thanks for this man of God that you've sent to us in this place. To be minister, to be pastor, and to be a friend. This morning, Lord God of hosts, I invite you and I ask you to fill Brian afresh with your spirit. Fill him to overflowing this morning. Anoint him, Lord God of hosts. As surely as Aaron was anointed and the oil ran down his beard onto his garments, Lord, drench Brian with your spirit just now. Give him confidence, not in himself, Lord, confidence in you. He brings your word to us. In Jesus' name.
Am I on? Yes. Good morning, everyone. It's good to see you. I prepared something for the church some time ago, and yet, at the same time, I felt that the timing wasn't right. And yet, I believe it is today. I want to approach it a little differently today, if I may. And I'm going to start off with a question. Has there ever been in the time of your life when you have said something you wished you hadn't? One or two. That you wish the ground would open up and swallow you. Or you would give anything to take back what you'd said. But how about this? And this is a million times worse. What if somebody had written down in a book what you had said? And for 2,000 years, your brothers and your sisters had read all about what you had said. Some of you may probably guess who I'm talking about here. Let me read then from Matthew 26, 69 to the end. And it's heading, Peter disowns Jesus. Now Peter was sitting out in the courtyard and a servant came to him. You also were with Jesus, she said. But he denied it before them all. I don't know what you're talking about, he said. Then he went to the gateway where another girl saw him and said to him, this fellow was with Jesus of Nazareth. He denied it again with an oath. I don't know the man. After a little while, those standing there went up to Peter and said, surely you were one of them, for your accent gives you away. Then he began to call down curses on himself. And he swore to them, I don't know this man. Immediately a cock crowed. Then Peter remembered the word Jesus had spoken. Before the cock crows, you will disown me 3 times. And he went outside. And he wept bitterly. This is often known as the Great Betrayal. The man who sold out Jesus. The man that deserted him. The man who was a coward. But how easy it is, brothers and sisters, to sneer at this man, Peter. As if we ourselves have never forsaken Jesus. Let me tell you, every time you sin, we deny the Lord. Every time we sell our Lord short. Every time we criticize a brother or a sister. Every time we withhold a blessing. Every time we don't love as we ought to. Every time we don't forgive. These are the times when we deny our Lord. You know, perhaps we're not sophisticated enough now to curse ourselves as Peter did. But is our track record that good enough to sit on judgment of Peter? I mean, after all, if Peter had acknowledged Jesus as his friend and his companion, they might have taken him, arrested him, and put him to death. Huh? And he knew this. Have we ever faced those consequences? And if we were to face these consequences in the future, admitting we know Jesus or denying him, what would you do? Verse 72. Oh, how Peter would have rubbed that out of the Bible. I don't know the man. The sin of denying Jesus. But again, let's not start swapping sins with Peter, because some of us might be here all night. Rather, let us go forward 7 weeks. 7 weeks, 50 days. And we pick up the story in Acts 2, while we find this Peter transformed. He's not the same man anymore. The man before was nothing like the man now. This man was different in every way. On Good Friday, he wouldn't accept it. He wanted to deny Jesus, distance himself from the Lord. But here he was, bold as brass, in front of thousands of people, declaring that this Jesus is the Christ, this Jesus is the Messiah, and not only that, you killed him. Would you do that in front of thousands of people? Huh? It took some guts to say that. And you read the crowds stood and listened. Peter reminded them that the same Jesus was the one you had crucified a few weeks before, and now Peter was telling them, you had killed him, this man. You had put him to death. Now the crowd could have turned on him. They could have torn him to pieces. They could have stoned him. They could have done anything with him. Because the memory of Jesus was still fresh in their minds. What on earth was Peter on about? It took some guts for this man to stand up and tell them like it was. And yet we read, when he stood up and preached to them, a miracle happened. Well, perhaps not one miracle. 3,000. Read Acts 2. Let me read Acts 2. If I can find it. Here we go. Acts 2. This is Peter talking. Therefore, let all Israel assured of this, God made this Jesus, whom you crucified, Lord of all. When people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and to the other, oh, brothers, what can we do? What can we do? And Peter replied, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. With many words you warn them, save yourselves from this corrupt generation. Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 3,000 were added to the church, to the kingdom that day. We read that they were cut to the heart. Sometimes you've got to read the Bible and fill in the details. What does that mean? I want you to imagine the scene, if you will. There's thousands there. They've come to hear this man preach. And they're going to tell them all about what they've done. And he didn't spare them. Grown men, when they heard the word, that we began to weep. They come from all over the Roman Empire, and here they were falling on their knees, crying out to God for forgiveness. Grown men rending their clothes in anguish. People scream out of repentance because they had slain the very Messiah they'd looked for, they'd hoped for, they'd prayed for, and when he came, they killed him. Can you imagine the state that these men must have been? Messiah they hoped for. They crucified. And through all the anguish, through all the beating of breath, through all the broken hearts, that day Peter goes on to give them hope. Give them hope. He said, look, it's all right. It's okay. Because this Christ, this man, this Jesus you crucified, resurrected. He rose from, and he is now King of kings and Lord of lords. Your act wasn't enough to kill this man, for he is the Christ. He is your Lord and your Savior. Saved 3,000 got into the kingdom. 3,000 became our brothers and sisters in the Lord. I don't know what was going on in heaven that day. I can imagine there'd be such a hullabaloo. Angels doing double somersaults, having a party. Hey, 3,000 got saved. Good old Peter. Okay. You've got to ask yourselves a question, haven't you? What on earth got hold of Peter? What on earth had transformed this coward, this runaway, this big mouth? Of course, God's Holy Spirit. We read in Acts 2:4, that in the upper room, the believers were filled with the Holy Spirit. And through this filling, they were empowered. That's the word, empowered, to take on the word. On the word. Jesus had kept his promise. He always does, of course. Earlier in the Last Supper, Jesus had been talking about the fact he was going to leave them. And they couldn't understand. They were frightened. They were puzzled. They were afraid. Jesus, you're leaving them. Come with you. No, you can't come with me. Not yet. But then he said, but I'm going to give you a comforter, a strengthener, an advocate, a counselor, the Holy Spirit, who will be with you and in you. And of course, as we know, the promise came 50 days later at Pentecost. The Holy Spirit got hold of Peter, and the man was never the same again. Earlier, Peter had cursed himself, trying to get away from Jesus, but now he was so empowered, he stood up in front of these people and he told them what it was. And this man was so empowered. This man, Peter, was so empowered that the only way they could stop him was to crucify him, which is what they did eventually. The Holy Spirit got hold of Peter in such a way, brothers and sisters, they say the rest is history. But, brothers and sisters, the question is, how much of a hold has the Holy Spirit got on us, on you and I? The great promise of Jesus was recorded in John 14. He says, he will dwell with you, and he will be in you. Now the Holy Spirit had been around in the Old Testament from the beginning, but the Holy Spirit had never been in anyone. This is something new. This is a whole new dimension. The Holy Spirit residing in you. And not just an occasional guest, but a permanent resident. So again, the question, we have the Holy Spirit, yes. But does the Holy Spirit have us? You know, we can grieve the Spirit with our angry words. We can resist the Spirit with our disobedience. We can even quench the Spirit by the lack of accepting on God's teaching, our lack of faith. There's all sorts of ways. So how do we keep in step with the Holy Spirit? How do we know that we have the Holy Spirit ruling in our hearts? Again, the quick and simple answer is easy. Galatians 5. We read of the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. 9 gifts. How many of those gifts do we have? And how many of those gifts do we exhibit to our brothers and our sisters, day by day by day? That perhaps is a mark of how much the Holy Spirit has a hold on us. It is true the Holy Spirit has to be in every Christian, otherwise it couldn't be a Christian. It's the Holy Spirit that convicts of our need of a Savior. But, it's more than that. See, I'm talking about the Holy Spirit that turned a traitor into a martyr, a man who was prepared to turn to face thousands, and even chose death rather than betray Jesus. That's the difference the Holy Spirit can make in our lives. He has been given to us, each one of us, not perhaps necessarily to face death, as Peter had to, but to live a life that is full of the fruit of the Holy Spirit. So again, question, do we really depend on him as we should? Or are we like the Galatians when Paul challenged them by saying, you started at the beginning by means of the Spirit, or you're now trying to finish by means of the flesh? In other words, are you trying to live the Christian life in your own strength or in the strength that God has given us? Listen to me, brothers and sisters. The disciples were with Jesus 3 and a bit years. They had close fellowship. They ate with him, they slept with him, they saw the miracles, they heard the preaching, they saw people being raised from the dead, demons being driven out. They was there when he was crucified. And yet, they still weren't ready to take on the world. They saw all of that, and they still weren't ready. And of course, Jesus knew it. That's why he told them to wait, don't go anywhere, but stay in Jerusalem until the Holy Spirit comes on you. Don't go. Stay. Wait. He's going to come. You're not ready until the Holy Spirit gets hold of you and uses you for the kingdom. Don't leave Jerusalem. And this was the Lord's direct command. Of course, that's what they did. They were obedient. They stayed there. And finally, they were empowered at Pentecost. And as the word says, they turned the world. And let me suggest, brothers and sisters, that if they had to have the Holy Spirit to empower them, how much more do we need him to do the work that Christ has commanded us to do? You know, when Peter stood up to preach, I don't believe it was Peter's words that convicted these people. It was the Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit that does the convicting of repentance and of salvation and the need of the Savior. No words can bring a man into the kingdom. It's got to be the Spirit of God exposing him by the word. If they needed him, so do we. Yes, Peter was anointed. Yes, he preached the gospel. Yes, he was courageous, but it was the Holy Spirit that convicted these people of their need. And if I was to ask, if someone was to ask me, what does the church worldwide need more than anything else today? It's only one answer. It has to be the Holy Spirit, the power of Christ, the power of the Father, the power of the Holy Spirit. I mean, we read the Bible here, 11 frightened men were in the upper room together with the others, 120 of them, wasn't there? the dead, but there was one called to pray. And then the Holy Spirit came, and these frightened men became giants for God. And the Church of Jesus Christ was born. Yeah. You read it, so the Acts of the Apostles, that's a misnomer. It shouldn't be called the Acts of the Apostles. It's the Acts of the Holy Spirit working through these people. Death, if necessary, for the sake of the gospel. They were empowered. They were anointed. They were giants for men, for God, because of the Holy Spirit. You know, perhaps as a local church, we need to rediscover perhaps to wait on the Holy Spirit as the early disciples were told to wait. Perhaps some of us need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Some of us perhaps need to be refilled with the Holy Spirit. Because this church, as in every other church in the kingdom, needs to be empowered. The Holy Spirit is not an add-on. It's not an extra. It's essential. Otherwise, we'd be doing everything in our own strength. Finally, let me quote from you a verse from the Epistle to the Church in Ephesus. This is Paul writing again. That you may know. In other words, he's saying, for heaven's sake, listen up. Hear what I'm going to say to you, because it's important. Talk to you about the hope to which he has called you, the riches of his glorious inheritance with the saints, and his great power to us who believe. The same power which God exerted in Christ when he raised him from the dead. That's right, the same power raised Christ from the dead is the same power that God wants to give us. I'm talking about resurrection power here. I'm talking about the power that rolled the stone away. I'm talking about the power that raised Jesus from the dead. That same power. That's what Paul's talking about. The same power. Resurrection power. Don't you think God wants us to have this power? Don't you realize that without this power, we are treading water at best? You see, the early church could do nothing without him, and neither can we. And I believe that if we are in earnest, and if we are perhaps in desperation, seeking the empowering of the Holy Spirit, then God will not deny us. Why should he? Why should he? Does he not love you as much as he loves Peter or Paul or any of the saints, the great ones? Are you exempt from his love? Does he ever pass you by? Does he not want to give you everything? Has he not already given you his son? I believe if we seek our Lord like this and wait on him, the Lord will begin to move among us. And he will take us out of our comfort zone. because he will expect us to have raw faith, to go and say things to people that we've never done before. But God wants to use us for his glory, for no other reason but for his glory. The Holy Spirit is our inheritance. He has been given. We as a church ought to embrace all that God has for us. That we should earnestly seek above all else the empowering of the Holy Spirit, that we may serve our Lord that bit better, that we may extend his kingdom. Set aside to do these things. You have each one of you, not the guy or the woman on your left or your right, but you. Will begin to minister to the needs of your people here, that the weak may be strong and the strong may be stronger again, that you'll give them a courage and a strength which they've never known before, that they may be emboldened to do the work of God. They may be courageous in what they say and do, that they will be mindful of the Holy Spirit within them, working through them, that, Lord, they may be instruments of your work in this fellowship, and doing to a place, Lord, in which people will see that your Holy Spirit active and amongst us with a free will to do whatever you want us to do. Lord, as you visited your early church, I pray you do that on this church. For bad times are coming, Lord. The end times are nearly amongst us. Lord, equip your saints. Protect your saints. Enable your saints. And give them all that they need to be the giants of the New Testament. Mercy on your people, Lord. And give us, Lord, which we need, which we desperately seek, to do the work of the kingdom.
System of playing the music, and it may, hopefully it will be easier to get in line and in tune with the singing. But nevertheless, when we open our mouths to praise God, even when it's out of tune, God hears and He wants to hear. Let's pray. Father, for these offerings this morning, we thank You for every set. Take our lives, take our gifts, Lord God of hosts, multiply them, for Your purpose is here. And now to Him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you before His glorious presence without fault and with great joy. To the only God, our Saviour, be glory, majesty, power, and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. And the people of God said, Amen. 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 Tea and coffee, folks. Have fellowship. Be careful.